So nowadays in China, government and people talk a lot about the supply side structural reform in the economic domain. So as an important sector, the HR, the human resource market, also possess very strong characteristics for the reform. Actually, there's a big gap between supply and demand side in the HR market for a long time. So one of the reasons is we lack necessary sufficient data or statistics to show the real need from industry, society, about the professional talents. So here I put several statements quoted directly from the UNESCO report published in 2010 about the urgent need for engineering profession and the engineering education statistics. So due to the importance and the urgency, this year UNESCO headquarters issued set up a key project of engineering initiative to build up engineering statistics among member states for the next 10 years. So the plan is every 2 years they organize a survey among 30 member states, and altogether in 10 years we probably can cover like 150 states. It's the most important country will be included. So actually they asked us in China to support financially, also start from China to do the survey and do some research on the indicator of engineering profession and engineering education, then collect the data according to the indicator. Another characteristics for supply side structural reform is overproduction. Actually, it's very obvious in HR market. This should be interpreted as two sides, two meanings. On one hand, there's an overbuilt low quality graduates. The sign is high unemployment rate among new graduates, college or any professional education in China and outside. This is a worldwide phenomenon. And another hand, there's no sufficient high quality graduates. That's why there's a great shortage of engineering talent or other category of professional talent in HR market for industry and society. So third characteristic is a balanced allocation of education resources between academic and professional oriented education. Also, in the government policy, they also is the same phenomenon. Number four, this isolated education environment from a society and the industry. We call this like a karaoke type of self-entertainment. So the education circle set up their own target and develop their process to cultivate talent. Also, they evaluate themselves within the isolated environment. Okay, not listen to the society, but listen to the industry. So, and the structural transformation and the upgrading of our professional education must be carried out to solve the problem. In terms of academia oriented to application oriented. So later I can show some number. the academic-oriented talent we really need, but only small portion of the whole HR market, probably only 1%, okay? But right now, in China, we have about 3,000 university college. Most of them are heading to academic oriented development. So we should adjust this arrangement. Also, the professionalism in education process always very weak and neglected. And the innovation and the entrepreneurship education is lacking in the normal education process, also professional education. And the teacher center should be transferred to a student center, and we need the infusion of a technical content and humanism and the cultural content. This was an important statement made by Professor Weiss yesterday. The UNESCO published a report in 1972 and indicate for the first time in history, some society are begin to reject many of the product of institutionalized education. This shows how easy educational system can become out of phase. Okay, that means that the gap between education and the society need is the education development too slow and left behind, cannot catch the speed of society, industry, technology development. So the largest human resource company called the Manpower, they for the past 10 years, they carry out the survey on the shortage of industry and the society for professional talent. So this is the spectrum for 42 countries. In 2005, they invested. In this spectrum, you can see the average worldwide the average rate of companies who cannot find the necessary people for their need is 38%. So the highest from the far left is Japan. That's 83%. For the past 10 years, from their survey, there's about 31% to 40%. Fluctuate during the past 10 years, the rate for the companies who cannot find the qualified people for their business. So this is top 10 job employer and having difficulty to fill in that top 10 position or job. According to their order and the content of the top 10 position, I do some simple correlation analysis. Here, the shortage of professional talent relate to different level of professional education. For middle vocational education, that's 3 items. And the higher education, that's 5 items. And that's 6 item, and for undergraduate study, that's 6 item. So for the simple correlation analysis, the worst is undergraduate study, then higher vocational education, then middle vocational education. So this is the data for China alone. In 2005, about 2,000 companies were sampled for the survey. You can see the content of the order of top 10 jobs is different from a global one. So that reflects the current state of China for transforming and upgrading their industry. What they have a special need, especially for high-end professional talent. The simple correlation analysis I did shows that undergraduate study is the most related to the shortage of the talent. And the high vocational education, the middle vocational education, then the last one, the graduate study, also related to the shortage. So this is what past 10 years engineering talent at the low-end, middle level, also high-end, always among the top four professional talent shortage, okay, for the past 10 years. And this is the reason for difficult filling job. The first number four, the first four reasons. So how to satisfy the key stakeholder for professional education? We can see graduates try to find a job, company try to recruit the qualified people, and the country, the state, try to build human resource strategy. All the three key stakeholder requirements point out to job market with the requirement of a professional career. So this is why we have to promote the professional career oriented professional education. So I use engineering human resource market at a different level of position corresponding to a different level of engineering education. So you can see in the top of a parallel, represented in red color, there's academic talent about 1% of 7.5 million high school graduates enter Chinese university and college for study. Even MIT, only 10 to 15% of undergraduate graduates, no matter, maybe they continue to study for master and PhD, but only 10 to 15 become academic talent. Not most people, 80% become engineers as an application oriented professional. So the traditional vocational education cover the range of low-end and middle-level professional talent, and professional education, another word, is cover the high-end professional talent from bachelor, master, all the way to PhD. So the generalized professional education should include all of them, because the two parts share the same common rule, common principle. Okay, so I think nowadays we should not only distinguish higher education with vocational education and continuous education, but we should put more emphasis on the common characteristics and the principle for all of them. So actually last century, around the 1980s or later, the university in North America, in both the US and Canada, discuss the future desired engineer for 21st century. So they view in the 19th century and the first half of the 20th century, the professional engineer only focus on technical stuff. But in the later of the 20th century, second half, they become a scientific engineer. But for next century, the engineer should be innovative, with the entrepreneurship, and require that they know everything, they can do anything, work with anyone, anywhere, also imagine imagination and make the imagination reality. So this is some explanation for each of them. So I can go to the detail. So yesterday, Professor Wary said, well, who will decide the knowledge or competence of the graduates you should have for professional education? Actually, this is desired attributes of an engineer suggested by Boeing company. You can see that this is like an entry-level engineer requirement. The first three items relate to design and manufacturing knowledge and skill. But the rest is 70% across all the professions in the job market. Okay. So that's why we have to pay attention to not only for technical staff of professional education, also like humanism and the cultural aspect of the required by the profession. So there's a huge gap between the cultural context of professional career and the professional education in the sixth respect. Actually, it's not limited to this aspect, and there's much more. So that's why I think we, as an engineer, as an engineer education institute, we have to learn a lot from the industry, the society, for their culture. So based on the analysis and the research, we propose five layers of paradigm for generalized professional education. The first two relate to the goal of education, and the third one is a strategy we propose to reach the goal. And the fourth layer is the model carried out the education practice in China and outside China, which are recommended by the UNESCO chair. And the last one, not least, we should carry out the student-centered, project-based active learning, and by making use of advanced education technology, especially ICT tools. So this is the 5E outcome-based engineering vision proposed by Group D of Leuven University. Dr. Johan de Graaf, the co-chairholder of my UNESCO chair. So the university carried out this, this model for the past 40 years. As 5 years stand for engineering, enterprising, educating, environmental, and assembling. I think this is an abstract reflection of requirement from engineering profession. Here I identified some roles of ICT in future professional education from macro level to micro level. Especially, I would like to make a comparison between personalized mass education versus customized mass production, manufacturing. Because I'm a mechanical engineer, for the past 30 years I have done a lot of research on computer integrated manufacturing, also intelligent manufacturing. So, my opinion is we have to change the learning paradigm to create a great need for ICT, not just push the student and teacher to use ICT tool. Give you a very concrete example. My aunt, who got her master from University of Michigan at Ann Arbor in 1935, long time ago. That's what I taught Dennis this morning as a social worker. She started to learn email, how to use the email and the internet at the age of 19. Okay. He used all the facility until his end of her life. That's died at the age of 105 years old. So the reason, very simple, because she the whole life deal with the people. At the age of 90, she got a problem and broken leg, have to use a wheelchair. So that's why she really need advanced technology to keep up with the work with her friend. He know more than 2,000 people worldwide, all the kind of people, very high level, even ordinary common people. Okay. 2 years ago, I visited the National University of Singapore. The VP academic and the provost told me describe the impact of ICT on professional education as a tsunami. So they are worried about how long the professional education, the traditional school, can last. So, as you know, we have a book as a center because it's a very valuable, very rare to access. Then we build up a library like the church, and we have a teacher as a main mediator to in between book and the student learning. So that's why we develop a teacher center and a classroom center. A student is passively learning, okay, in that time. Suddenly we covered by IT tools here as OER, MOOC, and cloud computing. And everybody, anywhere and anytime, if a student want to learn, a learner want to get the information, they not necessarily go to a library, go to a teacher, but they can get that information anywhere. However, for professional education, we still have another very important aspect. We need a lab, we need a professional training center. Now, in China, very, very public. For some universities, they have 30,000 square meter engineering training center. Not only for very basic skill of fabrication, but now become a maker space, become a platform for student-oriented active learning. Then the teachers, professors, together with experts from the industry, from the society, work with the student. Okay, I think this is a way I project that the professional education is heading to. So I would like to quote Professor John Davis' statement. He said, "You will teach today as we taught yesterday, we rob our children tomorrow." So we must continuously improve our education because education is the most innovative business. Thank you very much.
Спасибо большое, профессор Чай, за ваше выступление, которое одновременно было и очень содержательным, и очень вдохновляющим, воодушевляющим. Спасибо большое. Я думаю, что тема профессионального образования, его развитие достаточно важно для нашей аудитории. Я думаю, что сейчас как раз у вас есть возможность задать профессору Чжан вопрос.
Thank you, Mr. Chan. Excellent presentation. You covered many different issues. My question is about your paradigm change. There are many kinds of paradigm changes, as you know. And I was curious, the title of your speech is on supply side. And I've been interested in the demand side. And I wonder if, let us take your case, you mentioned we were talking before, as you remember, about your aunt or grandmother who had studied in the United States. And so perhaps in your family you had an awareness that education in the United States might be an interesting opportunity. Of course, most Chinese did not have that in their family. And so the question comes up many times in my country, in the United States, where students are not aware of the possibilities. So they go through school each year, and maybe they go for a bachelor's degree, master's degree, PhD degree, and they find they don't have a job. This is in part what we're talking about. But it's partly, in my view, the lack of understanding of the job market and the job opportunities that students have, and even people who are not students, who are out of school. Therefore, the demand is partly the demand for what you're providing. It partly depends on whether they understand what the options are for them. Families do that, but I'm wondering in your work in China, and maybe globally, whether there's a study of how students understand what opportunities are. That's the demand side. How would they know to be a mechanical engineer, or a chemical engineer, or a digital expert, or a programmer? How do they know that? Is there any process in China to try to provide that information in an effective way? Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel, for your comment and question. Very good one. And when we talk about the supply side structure reform, it doesn't mean this is not related to the need of the demand side. Okay. The two sides actually hand jointly very closely. Actually, nowadays the problem in China or worldwide, the education sector in an isolated environment, and they carry out, like I said, the self-entertainment type of education. But on the other side, industry complain about this, but never give hand to education. Okay, they are waiting for talent. Yeah. So this is why we propose three strategies. One of them is the university-industry collaboration. And this is very important. Because I think in United States and in the developed countries, this is better than China. Because we all the students, like 215 million students, all kind of students in China, they always in an isolated environment, not open to society, not open to the industry. So this creates severe problem. So to answer your question, if they want the student to get to know what's the option, what's the possibility, first of all, we should give them opportunity to contact the society, the industry. Then to get some knowledge, okay, not the theoretical knowledge, but the practical knowledge about what the thing important and really need for their whole life professional career. Okay, start from a very young age, like a step. I think American government published a document, state documents about 4 years ago, talk about the engineering K-12 in education. So this is very, very important. Our UNESCO chair also work with people in the fundamental education sector, start from kindergarten now, to train the kid with very little things. Let them have an opportunity to use their hand, use their brain to realize the real world problem and try to solve it. From a very simple one, then gradually go to a complicated or real world problem. I think the key is break the isolated environment of nowadays education.
Thank you for this afternoon. Good presentation. I have a brief comment and experience from Finland and from a big company. You may still know and remember Nokia. We started in the 90s to invest a lot for engineering education, professional education. And I remember when I started e-learning things at university 15, 16 years ago, and Nokia Vice President Mr. Salminen at that time, he explained that, look, they have e-learning every day, 55,000 learners inside the company. I had 5 or 6 students. Of course, massive advantage to the company. Now, unfortunately, many of the Nokia engineers are unemployed in Finland. Unemployed, highly trained engineers that we, the society, the state, paid. So my question, not another question, but my remark is that how to combine the industrial need and then the educational, professional educational side to guarantee that those people who are highly experts, highly trained experts, when things change in industry, they still could be employed or find something else to do. And in education, you have to have the flexibility, the basis. We have to create not only the cognitive and but the attitudinal attitudes basis for motivation to learn and to change radically. And for the engineering people, I don't know if I can generalize. My own son is technology director. I don't want to speak about the family, but I think that this is the challenge.
Yeah.
How to combine the growth competencies that you presented and I wanted to come. I'm very happy to work with this. I can say thank you. I don't have a question, but I have a question. Can we trust the big corporations only? This is a big debate. Will they take care about the educational basis? They are interested in short-term profits. But we as educators, we are interested in the people to guarantee that good life is guaranteed also for engineers. Thank you.
Thank you, Tabio, for your valuable comments. So I fully agree with you. So this is why we have to reform our professional education. But the professional education at a different level, from a middle vocational, high vocational, all the way to PhD, I think the severe problem is they only concentrate on technical stuff. So that's a shortcoming of professional education before. This is why the so highly trained engineers that lost the job. So now we have to use innovation, entrepreneurship, education into professional education. So I think this is the stage not right now in China and worldwide. Actually, 4 years ago, I visited Architel headquarters at in Belgium, okay? I talked to the general manager. He's a good guy and graduate from University Lowell grew tea in the 70s. He knew, as long as he knew, I served as a board member for group tea for past 10 years. So he said, this is a very good college. He was a major in electronics. But he said at that time, in the 1970s, even this school taught students not only technical stuff, but management, but communication, teamwork, and economic. So that's why he said he can reach the high position as the general manager of for the whole company. Okay. So I think some university really have a far sight on the education goals, like Johan Graf, my partner. He led the college since 78, something like that, at the age of 27, because his father passed away suddenly. He had to take the job as president of the college. And I do agree with you. We have to be flexible, like a flexible manufacturing, like computer-aided manufacturing systems, to meet so many variety of need among our customers. Now we talk about the personalized mass education. So we have to be flexible, not like the past for the past 100 years, 50 years. We have a so rigid structure of education, especially in China. If you want to change something, you always have the bureaucracy to against you. However, some universities already realize that we have to be flexible to meet the need, various need of